Hello, this is Charles Anderson doing another ACM video. Thank you for your interest. Several of you have left comments and likes. I appreciate that very much. Thank you. A few people have left dislikes. If you are not happy with what I'm doing, please could you leave a comment as well? That way I can either adjust the video or correct it or put in something that was missing. Okay, what I'm going to do today is kind of a recap of some of the dynamics and some of the reactor systems. So I think that was similar to videos 8, 9, and 10 that I did earlier. So there'll be a little bit of recap, but really what I was doing the other day was I was putting together a model, and it occurred to me that there were a couple of tricks that might be useful for other people putting these models together the first time around. And so I thought I'd share them. Okay, so a very quick recap on what we've seen before. What I've done is I've used my existing tank model to, I'm going to inherit that, so that gives me my hold up and my energy balance and all that sort of good stuff. That's going to be my steady state fermentation. I'm going to use an external structure to define my reaction kinetic parameters. So if I come to structures, I've defined my fermentation by saying these are the components that are going to react. These are the components that are substrates. These are the ones that are inhibitors. And these are the reaction names. And that's going to let me put in some Michaelis-Menten kinetics with inhibition terms if I want, and the stoichiometry of the individual reactions. So over here, I've called an instance of that structure. And that's then going to be used to dimension an extent of reaction. In other words, what mass fraction of material coming in is going to get converted and into what or down which reaction pathway. What's my molar flow rate of reactions? And then that then lets me put together my reaction constant or my reaction rates for the three reactions. And then the overall rate of reaction is that molar rate of reaction times the stoichiometry of the component in that reaction summed over all the reactions times the molecular weight to give me a mass of component I that's being made or if it's negative, destroyed, consumed. So that's my reaction configuration. That's my stoichiometry. As always with a structure, I define the way in which the structure is put together, and then I create an instance of it so that then at the flow sheet level, I have an instance of that structure that has the data in it. The reason I have the structure is so that I use exactly the same parameters everywhere in the model if I have multiple copies of the reactor. And the reason they have this structure of declaring the structure and then instantiating it is so that I can have different kinetics or different component sets in different parts of the system. So for example, I may want to have the same reaction structure for glucose to ethanol, and then somewhere else I might have ethanol forming acetic acid. It'll be the same basic reactions, but I'll have different reactions set up in that system. Like I have with properties here, I've got water, air, and ammonia defined as separate properties. Right. The other thing that I'd done, I skipped over that, was one of the tests I want to do is make sure that my reaction stoichiometry works so that my mass balance closes and my sum of rates of reaction equals zero. So I've created a dummy variable test mass, and I'm going to see if that test mass value actually is zero when I run the model. And we see that no, it's not. I'm slightly off on my overall mass. So what I want to do is I want to have a quick look at my stoichiometry and make sure I haven't made a mistake there. I look down my stoichiometry and I see that the glucose stoichiometry for biomass creation, it looks like it's a number that I might have rounded. So what I'm going to do is, rather than going back and retesting everything, I'm going to be lazy. I'm going to force the mass balance to close by fixing that test mass to zero. There's only one instance of it at the moment in the flow sheet, so that's fine. I free the stoichiometry for the glucose. I rerun the model, and you can see, yeah, it looks like I rounded that number to 692, where it was actually 691611. So now my mass balance closes. My stoichiometry is hopefully correct. If I was being very thorough, I might do an elemental balance to make sure my carbon, nitrogen, hydrogen, and so on all balance. But I'm going to assume I've done that and leave that as an exercise for the student, should you wish. Okay, so the next thing I want to do is... The next thing I want to do is to make sure that the structure is correct. So what I've done is I've got an all liquid fermentation, but in fact I'm making carbon dioxide. So because I've chosen to use a liquid only model for my holdup, what I want to do then is take that liquid and run it through a flash to make sure that I release that carbon dioxide. So let's have a quick look at the results for that flash. If I look at that, I see that there's a bunch of glucose in the vapor phase. That's clearly something that's a bit of a concern. The reason that is I've chosen to define the physical properties for glucose, at least the vapor liquid equilibrium properties for glucose myself, knowing that it's non-volatile. Rather than having Aspen do a detailed flash calculation, what I've done instead is I've come in and defined the vapor pressure for glucose. But it looks like I've left it set at its default value of 1. That's way too high. So I'll send it to 1e to the minus 12, which happens to be the lower bound value for glucose. If I now rerun the model, you'll see that instead of being 0.2%, I've essentially got no glucose in my vapor phase as I expected. Again, it's a shortcut. I'm trying to make the model run more quickly and more robustly. If I were keen, I would do a full-blown mass balance or VLE calculation on the glucose. The next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to have a look at the liquid phase. And what I'll see is that there's quite a lot of carbon dioxide there, far more than I'd expect, 2.2% after a flash at 40 C. That seems high. The reason for that is that in my Aspen properties, I chose to use the NRTL, the non-random two liquid model, to describe my physical properties. And that doesn't do a great job of describing very volatile components. So typically what you do in Aspen properties is define those as Henry components. It turns out, I think, that when you then use the Aspen properties in ACM, it doesn't pick up that Henry component by default. So what I need to do is come to my component lists, find the one that I'm using to define the physical properties, edit that. That shows me which properties are being used. And then if I hit this edit physical properties, I can see which overall model I'm using. And then over here, I can see which Henry components I'm using. And you can see it's defaulted to none. I need to have it use gases, which is the way in which I set it up in Properties Plus. So that defines CO2 as an Henry component. So then if I do all that, get it ready to run, I'll have a look and it'll come from 0.22 to 0.011. So you can see a sort of order of magnitude of a factor of 20 reduction in the concentration of CO2, and that's a more reasonable number. Okay, so I have made sure my stoichiometry is correct. I've made sure my vapor liquid equilibrium is correct. The last thing I'm going to do is, if I consider this system as a whole, I want to make sure that I've got my enthalpies of reaction or my starting points on my enthalpies correct so that I get the right heat of reaction. To do that, what I'm going to do is use variables from a couple of different places. So I've created a quick summary table to do that. What I want to do is I want to now work out what I've done is I've set myself up with 5,000 kilos of 20% glucose solution coming in. So I've got 1,000 kilos an hour of glucose coming in. That just makes the maths easier to deal with in a moment. Then what I'm going to do is I'm going to say, okay, I want the thing to be isothermal, so I'm going to work out what the heat of reaction is. So what I'll do is I've got a dummy variable that determines the heat. I can add heat or remove heat from the fermenter. So I'll free that, and then I'll fix the temperature out of this flash fermenter to be 25. So the same as the stream coming in. That gives me the isothermal then heat of reaction. In this case, I've got 1,000 kilos of glucose coming in, so divide this by 1,000. That tells me I've got 0.363 megajoules per kilogram, or 363 kilojoules per kilogram of heat that's being formed, so I have to remove that from the fermenter. And I can cross-check that with my system. What you'll notice, though, is I've got several reactions turned on. So let's, just to make the maths easier, I'll turn off everything. I'll do 100% conversion of glucose into ethanol. And so that then tells me this is my heat of reaction for the ethanol stage, for the fusel oil formation, and so on. So I can work through and work out exactly what my heats of reaction are and make sure that I've got those set at reasonable values. If they're not reasonable, then I need to come into my physical properties and adjust the H0, the starting enthalpy of the components, to make sure that it's all self-consistent. Okay, so that's now tested my thermodynamics package. It's tested my structure of the reactions. Now it's time to get down to my dynamic model. Here's one I prepared earlier. The dynamic model is basically the same as the steady state model. It's inheriting from the tank. I've got molar rate of reaction. In this case, I've defined it per gram of biomass. I've got an availability and inhibition term, which are the Michaelis-Menten type calculations. And then I'm going to give myself a specific rate of reaction. And then once again, that stoichiometry. I'm leaving out the mass balance test because if the balance happens works in one place, it should work in all the other places, I hope. And so there's my system set up. Because I'm doing a dynamic simulation, I now can't make the simplification of just having the flash at the end. So I'm still with a simplified model. I'm still doing my fermentation in the liquid phase and running it through a flash. But now what I'm going to do is I'm going to force a significant flow rate around this loop so that I continuously remove carbon dioxide. If I got really keen, I would rewrite this whole thing as a reactive rate-based vapor-liquid hold-up system. And I could do that. I'm just being lazy for this demonstration purposes. The other thing that I've done is I've thrown a cooler into that recycle loop so that I've now got a means of controlling temperature in the system. And I've put in a level controller rather than using a wear calculation, just because that makes the transition from steady state to dynamic slightly easier. One thing that's just occurred to me, I just need to double check, is that I left my steady state model in the appropriate format. And good job I checked. So I still have the temperature fixed and the duty free, and that's actually a non-feasible initial condition or specification, I should say, for a dynamic model. So if I flip those back, I remain square and it's all the same as steady state. But now when I move over to dynamics, it won't give me an error message. Okay, so flip over to dynamic mode. What I've done is I've set myself up with a task so that I change the set point from being almost empty, 10 to the minus 3, up to 100%. I then wait until the tank is 95% full, stop the feed, then wait for the fermentation to continue until I've got less than 0.5% of glucose, and that's what I call done for my fermentation. So the other thing, I can't remember if I've demonstrated before, there's a cute feature in ACM where you can capture the screen layout. So if you start popping open tables and sort of putting them in places where you would like them to be, you can force ACM to remember how you had the flow sheet set up. So I've done that, and so I can invoke the script that then sort of places the windows where I like them. The nice feature, at least if you're anal like me, is you can then come in and edit that script and make sure that the windows exactly line up and that you've got nice crisp corners and things don't overlap each other. Maybe that's just me though. Okay, so for dynamic mode, I am going to hit run and just make sure that it's working. You run along, you see at 1.8, the tank was full, so the level stops increasing. My level is still short of the set point, so my discharge valve remains closed. Once it's running, it's consuming glucose, it's forming biomass and ethanol, and obviously the more biomass it forms, the faster the reaction goes, because it's self-catalyzing, if you like. So you can see the simulation runs. It's going to get at here about 50-60 hours, and then it's going to stop. So that's, there you go, nice dynamic simulation doing its thing, behaving like I wanted it to do. One last thing I'll show, if you remember when I set this task up, I hard-coded the level and the ending point for the glucose concentration. So that means that if I want to change them, I have to actually recompile the whole model because the task is essentially part of the flow sheet, and that then is forces you to recompile the whole thing, which makes it difficult to change things interactively in during a dynamic run. What I sometimes do is set the model up such that I use variables to define those endpoints. And so what I've done here is I've created flow sheet level variables for the tank level and the ending glucose concentration, and then I can reference those variables in the task directly. Depending on the version of ACM you're working in, these variables may or may not be recognized as active variables if they only appear in the task. So to force it to always show up, I've put in a dummy calculation that just sums all those display variables together, and that forces them to show up in the table at any time. Okay, so now I've got basically the same setup, and I can rerun the model, but I can now choose to fill the tank to a lower level, and I'll maybe stop at 10% glucose instead of 0.5% glucose. The final thing I'm going to do is I'm going to set my solver reporting level to zero just to make it easier to see what's happening. So I'll hit run. You'll see it's not ticking over the time, or you can still see where it is in terms of time here. You can see now that instead of 1.8 hours, it's 1.71 hours that it reaches that 90% level. It doesn't hit 90% exactly. That's because I haven't forced it to, but if I have a look at the integrator, I can force it to find those discontinuities and reinitialize and things like that. So if I check this box, it'll find that more accurately. I can also change the tolerance for events on the tolerances tab. Otherwise, it's running through and doing the same sort of thing as the other model does. You can see I reached 10% earlier, so the model stops at 46 hours rather than 60 hours. But otherwise, it's behaving much like the other system. Okay, I think that's what I wanted to show. Hopefully that's useful. Do give me some feedback. If it is, feel free to like it. If it isn't useful, please give me a comment and tell me what it is that I could do to improve. Thank you very much.